ओम नमः शिवाय। सो दिस इज रवि अगेन फ्रॉम शिवानंद आश्रम एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू हैव अ ब्रीफ ओवरव्यू ऑफ चैप्टर 9 ऑफ द भगवद गीता। बिफोर दैट प्लीज जॉइन मी इन द प्रेयर्स। ओम गजाननम उद्गनादिसेवितं कपीतजम्बोफलसारभक्षितं उमासुतं शोकविनाशकारणं नमामि विघ्नेश्वरपादपङ्कजं षडाननं कुंकुमरक्तवर्णं महामतिं दिव्यमयूरवाहनं रुद्रस्य सुनूं सुरसेननाथं गुहां सदाहं शरणं प्रपद्ये। या कुन्देन्दुतुषारहारधवला या शुभ्रवस्तावृता या वीणावरदन्दमन्दितकरा या श्वेतपद्मासना या ब्रह्माच्युतशङ्करा प्रभृतिभिः देवैः सदा पूजिता सा मां पातु सरस्वती भगवती निशेषजार्यापहा। ओम नमः शिवाय गुरुवे सच्चिदानंदमूर्तये निष्प्रपंचाय शांताय श्री शिवानंदाय ते नमः श्री विष्णुदेवानंदाय ते नमः। ओम सर्वमंगलमंगल्ये शिवे सर्वार्थसाधिके शरण्ये त्र्यंबके गौरी नारायणी नमोस्तुते नारायणी नमोस्तुते। ओम शांति शांति शांति। ओम तत्सत। ओम नमः शिवाय। सो वी सॉ इन द लास्ट क्लास लास्ट सेशन वी हैड टॉक्ड अबाउट द 8th चैप्टर व्हिच वाज Describing largely worship of Saguna Ishvara, the Lord with form. And we said that it gives a sequential form of liberation which we call Krama Mukti and not Jivan Mukti. And we said that this was not a preferred route. And that is proved by the fact that only in the 8th chapter does this reference to Krama Mukti come up. Krishna does not talk about that again in the Bhagavad Gita, indicating that it's an exceptional route and it is not to be preferred. The preferred route, of course, is Krama Mukti. It is, of course, Jivan Mukti. Okay, so how is it that this Jivan Mukti is to be attained? What is the recommended route? That is the question. So we say that once a person comes on the spiritual path, he comes to Saguna Ishvara Upasana for some time, which means he comes to the worship of a Lord, which can be either the Lord with one form or the Lord as the universe itself, depending upon the person's maturity level. And after having come to Saguna Upasana and spent sufficient time in the Saguna Upasana, that person matures out and gets ready for Jnanam, which we call Nirguna Ishvara Jnanam. Another name for Nirguna Ishvara Jnanam is Shravanam, Mananam and Nididhyasanam, which means study of the scriptures. Shravanam indicating listening to a teacher, Mananam indicating contemplating on those teachings, and Nididhyasanam indicating that one assimilates the teaching with continued meditation. And what is the benefit going to be? It's going to be Jivan Mukti itself. The oneness between Brahman or between Ishvara and yourself is realized in this very lifetime itself while you are living, while you are still in this body. So in the 3 or 4 chapters which follow from now, 9th, 10th, 11th and 12th, Lord Krishna prescribes upasana as a means of coming to Vedanta Vichara. So first you have to prepare your mind. Your mind has to be focused. And therefore this upasana, this meditation upon the Lord with form is prescribed. So Krishna says that apparently worship of Nirguna Ishvara seems to be difficult, but that is only apparent, because once the mind is prepared, this path is not difficult. How should one prepare for Nirguna Jnanam? How should one prepare for Jnana Yoga itself, for meditation on the formless Lord, which is Nirguna Ishvara Upasana? The preparation is worship of the Lord with form, Saguna Ishvara Upasana. So in the introduction to this chapter, Krishna mentions the subject matter, which is Nirguna Ishvara Jnanam, and this is called a secret because it requires a prepared mind to be able to understand this jnanam, understand this knowledge. Hence it is called Rajagohyam, the highest of all secrets, because it is the king of secrets. Why? Because it is the only discipline which liberates, and therefore it is called Rajavidya, the king of knowledge also. It's also called Gohyam because unless your mind has been sufficiently prepared, you will not be able to take advantage of this knowledge, even should you be exposed to it. And the preparation required, Krishna mentions Shraddha as one of the essential qualifications. So Shraddha is devotion, being patient, giving time to the study of the scriptures without rejecting the teaching, and staying with the teaching and the teacher until such time as I understand this teaching. So what is the advantage of this preparation? It is knowledge about the formless Ishvara, Nirguna Brahman. And then in the next few verses, Krishna mentions the nature of this Nirguna Brahman, this Nirguna Ishvara. So he says in verse number 4, Maya tatamidam sarvam jagadavyakta murtina matsthani sarva bhutani nachaham teshva vasthitaha. He says, this entire universe is pervaded by me. Maya sarvam tatam. The entire universe is pervaded by me. I am present in the universe itself. And what sort of form do I have? Avyakta murtina. He says, my form is unmanifest. So this Nirguna Ishvara, this Brahman, he pervades this whole universe, but at the same time he cannot be seen because the form is unmanifest. And he says, aham nateshu avasthitaha sarva bhutani matsthani. At the same time he says, this entire universe is present in me. At the same time, I am not present in them. So he is saying that there is a one-way equation, there is a one-way dependence. The universe is dependent upon me for its very existence. Why? Because when he says that I am present in the universe, it is like the gold saying that I am present in all the ornaments, which means the ornaments are dependent upon the gold. They cannot exist without the gold. At the same time, whether the ornament is there or destroyed, it doesn't affect the gold. The gold continues to be even when the ornament has been melted and is destroyed. Similarly, he says, this Nirguna Ishvara is present in the entire universe as the very substance of which the universe is made. And therefore, the universe has a dependence for its existence on this Ishvara, on this Nirguna Brahman. At the same time, Brahman itself, Nirguna Ishvara itself, is independent of the universe for its own existence. So from this fourth verse to the tenth verse is the main topic of the ninth chapter. It contains the essence not only of the Bhagavad Gita, of all the Upanishads also. Because Bhagavad Gita, it must be remembered, is a summary, it's the essence of all the Upanishads. And what is being discussed? The higher nature of the Lord is being discussed, and various aspects of this higher nature are pointed out. So he says, avyakta murtihi, attributeless or formless. So vyakta means what is graspable by the sense organs. So indriya gocharam, and here avyakta means indriya agocharam, meaning what the or sense organs cannot perceive. Perceive has to be taken as not only see but hear, touch, taste, all the five sense organs. So avyaktam means indriya agocharam, not available for grasp by any of the sense organs. And there is an important corollary to this. If the higher nature of the Lord is not available for perception or for experiencing, then what about those people who say that I have experienced the Lord, I have seen the Lord, or the Lord has spoken to me? It means that whatever has been experienced is not the higher nature of the Lord. It is the lower nature only. And if someone has experienced the Lord as a form, as a sound, as a light, anything, that is indeed a great event. But one must understand that it is a manifestation of the finite aspect of the Lord and not of the infinite Lord, because by definition the infinite aspect is the higher nature and it is not available for any sort of experiencing. So that's the first part of avyakta. Then this verse says idam sarvam tatam. Idam sarvam, the entire universe, whatever I can see, is pervaded. Tatam means pervaded, present in, or vyaptam as we call it in Sanskrit. So this is pervaded intimately by Brahman, by the higher nature of the Lord, which means the entire universe contains the higher nature of the Lord through and through. Then again he says mattani sarva bhutani, the whole world, the whole entire universe, all of creation is resting in me, all things and all beings. And Shankara in his commentary to this, to the Gita, he explains that this means from Lord Brahma to a bunch of grass also. So everything that is there, from the highest God to the lowest of all animate or inanimate beings, they are all present. They are all present in the Lord, which means the Lord is a support, the substratum of the entire universe. At the same time, he says, Nacha aham teshva vastitaha. I am not supported by the world. And therefore, this has to be understood, as I said, in the terms of what is independent existence and what is dependent existence. So, independent existence we call satyam, dependent existence we call mithya. So, in the gold chain example, or the gold bangle example, the lump of gold, if it is taken as independent existence, then the chain of the bangle or the necklace, that is dependent existence, because without the gold, the bangle cannot exist, the chain cannot exist. So this bangle or chain is mithya, while the gold itself is satyam. How do you understand? The gold pervades the bangle. The gold is present in the bangle. The gold is present in the necklace, and therefore there can be no existence of either the necklace or the bangle without the gold. What is the necklace and the bangle? After all, these are only forms, and the forms have been given a name, and the form is always dependent upon the substance. So that is what is being meant by independent existence and dependent existence. And Krishna here is saying that this universe, it is dependent upon the Lord for existence. At the same time, the Lord continues to be even if the universe is no longer there. Just like the gold continues to be even if the necklace has been destroyed or melted. So that's one more aspect. Then he says, he comes to the process of the creation of the universe. And he says, Sarva bhutani kaunteya prakritim yanti mamikam kalpakshaye punastani kalpadau visrajamyaham. He says, hey Arjuna, At the end of each cycle of creation, all beings are resolved into my own nature, into Prakriti. And again, once the creation starts again, at the beginning of the next cycle, I create this entire universe and all its beings once again. So before creation of the universe, one has to understand that the scripture says the universe has always been there. The very important aspect. The universe has always been there. Why can you not see it before the creation? Because it is present in an unmanifest form or a potential form. And therefore the scripture is saying that really speaking, there is no creation at all. What we call creation is just conversion of the unmanifest form into the manifest form. What we call dissolution or destruction of the universe or pralayam is the conversion of the manifest form of the universe into the unmanifest form. So Vedanta is putting forward a theory that nothing new can ever be created by anyone, including the Lord. Even though the Lord is considered omnipotent, he cannot create even 1 gram of matter. So because he says, I do not create a world at all. That's why he says that world is existent in me and was existent in me. And when this world is dissolved, it goes back into me. So Lord is saying that where is the question of creation? The world is in me always. Sometimes it is there in the unmanifest form. And when it is manifest, I am the world. And that is what you call creation. So what is the difference? This unmanifest form is the seed form, the potential form. The universe exists as potential form with names. And that unmanifest form is what is called Prakriti or Maya. In fact, Maya has got this very interesting derivation. Ya ma iti Maya. That which is not, that is Maya. So this Maya is the unmanifest potential form of the manifest universe. And when that conversion of that unmanifest Maya into manifest Maya takes place, that process is called creation or Srishti. But really speaking, what is it? It's only a shift in form from the invisible state to the visible state. And when the world is destroyed, what happens? There is a shift again, but from the visible state, from the manifest state to the unmanifest, to the invisible state, there really is nothing called creation. It is always a change of state only. And therefore he says, Sarva Bhutani Prakritim Yanti. This is the second part. When the world is destroyed, when the universe is destroyed, when it reaches the end of its current cycle, what happens? All beings, Sarva Bhutani, Yanti, come back to Prakriti, come back to my Prakriti, which is unmanifest Maya. Everything comes back to unmanifest Maya on the dissolution of the world. And this Maya is Mamika, it belongs to me, it is dependent upon me. Just as this manifest world exists by being dependent upon me, this Maya also is dependent upon me. It's interesting to note, he does not say, all beings come to me. He says, all beings go to my Prakriti. Prakriti here is Maya. So the wordings here, very carefully studied, indicate that Krishna talks about Prakriti, unmanifest state, existing in him, all right. But he doesn't say they come to me. He says they go to my Maya. And this unmanifest Maya is also dependent upon the Lord. So what is the point emerging from the discussion? All beings emerge from Maya and resolve into Maya, not into Nirguna Brahman. वी डू से इनटू ईश्वरा बिकॉज ईश्वरा इज ब्रह्मन प्लस माया. बट रिमेंबर दैट इफ यू आर रियली डूइंग एनालिसिस, ईश्वरा इज द कॉज सोलली बिकॉज ऑफ माया. ईश्वरा इज कॉल्ड द क्रिएटर ओनली बिकॉज माया एग्जिस्ट्स एंड एवरीथिंग कम्स फ्रॉम माया एंड गोज बैक इन टू माया अलोन. सो ब्रह्मन एक्ट्स एज अ कैटलिस्ट इन इट्स प्रेजेंस. माया प्रोक्रिएट्स, माया डिस्ट्रॉयज. सो इट्स अ साइकिल, दिस क्रिएशन एंड डिस्ट्रक्शन. देयर नेवर इज एनी परमानेंट एंड टू क्रिएशन. देन कैरिंग ऑन अबाउट the creation, he says, prakritim swamavashtabhya visrajami punaha punaha bhutak gramam imam kritsnam avasham prakritir vashat. He says, resorting to my prakriti, I create again and again. And what do I create? This entire mass of beings, the entire multitude of beings I create. And this is helpless. This creation is helpless because it is under the control of Maya. It's under the control of Prakriti. He is again discussing creation. So he says, Aham punaha punaha visrajami. I create repeatedly. I create again and again. The process is cyclic. Again, a very important teaching of Vedanta. Vedanta says creation is a cyclic process, not a linear process. And unless one adjusts one's understanding to look at creation as a cyclic process, one will find that a linear view presents lots of problems in understanding. And therefore, one of the first things taught when one studies Vedanta is that learn to look at creation as a cyclic process. It is not linear at all. And therefore, one of the most important questions which can never be asked, which is asked by a lot of people because they look at creation as linear. What is that question? When did creation begin? If you look at creation as a cyclic process, the question is illogical. Why? Because in a circle, where is the beginning and where is the end? You can put your finger on any point in the circle, there will be a previous point. So the question of begin does not arise at all. So he says here, he creates. How? With the help of Maya, which is the potential universe. And just as without the previous experience, you cannot dream, without the potential existence of the universe, Ishvara cannot create. And this potential form, we said, is called Maya or Prakriti. And with the help of this Prakriti, with the help of this potential universe consisting of names and forms, potential names and forms, he says, Imam Kritsnam Bhutak Gramam. This multitude of beings and things I create. And how? Avasham. Without control, helplessly. It cannot be stopped. Because as long as karma is there, the world will be required for the jivas to experience the effects of karma. And therefore, we say creation is a cyclic process because karma is always there. So, Prakritir Avashat here indicates that there is no free will of Ishvara, so to say, being used here. Because karma is the factor, and as long as karma is there, the Lord has no option but to create. He does not have the option to say, okay, I won't have the next creation, because karma is still present. And therefore, another very important question which can never be asked, why did Ishvara create the universe? He is avasham, he is helpless, because karma is there. And this giant wheel, the process of going, birth happening, life happening, death happening, again birth happening. So, punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam, we say. That can never be stopped. That wheel can never be stopped. There is only one way out from that giant merry-go-round, because it doesn't stop. If you want to get off the merry-go-round, what must you do? You have to jump off. And this jumping off is what is called moksha or liberation. And that's why Krishna says, Prakrite avashat. I have no choice in this creation. Bound by the karma of the beings, of the jivas, bound by their past karma, I have to create and keep on creating. So this is the theory of creation as put forward in the Vedas. Now, before moving any further, let us summarize the main topic of this chapter, which is the higher nature of the Lord. So what all did we see? This is also called para prakriti, by the way, the higher nature. And the lower nature is called apara prakriti. So now we are talking about the higher nature, para prakriti. So first thing we learnt was Ishvara sarvagataha. He is all pervading, present everywhere. Therefore, what are the implications? The Lord is not located in a particular place. He is not, therefore, not limited by space. If you are saying the Lord is present everywhere, something which is present everywhere is what? It is formless and therefore not limited by space. So if you say the Lord is in Vaikuntham or in Kailasha, it is wrong, because you should be saying the Lord is also there in Kailasha or also there in Vaikuntham. And if you are looking at the Lord as present only in a particular place, then you are looking at Saguna Brahman, the Lord with form. And this is okay. For a beginner in the spiritual line, he will need a formed Lord for worship. So Saguna Brahman is okay, but only for a start. One has to grow beyond. So first portion is the Lord is present everywhere. Then the second one was avyaktam, not available for perceptions by the sensory organs. Therefore, any manifestation of the Lord which I experience is only the lower nature of the Lord. So apara prakriti, the higher nature is beyond experience. Then the lower nature is what we call mithya jagat adhishthanam. Support, the higher nature is the support of the lower nature. Without the higher nature, the lower nature cannot exist. So this is the example we gave of the necklace not existing without the gold. If gold is the higher nature, the name and the form, the necklace is the lower nature. And therefore, if Brahman is higher nature, then this universe, which is name and form, is the lower nature. And it cannot exist without the substratum, which is the higher nature. Then there is a swarupa, there is a nature of the Lord, which we call asanga, not connected. Even though this universe is supported by the Lord, the impurities of the world do not taint the Lord. So to understand that, you look at space. Even though all buildings, all mountains, the dirtiest of places, dirtiest of gutters, the cleanest of temples are all accommodated in space, space is not touched either by the cleanliness of the temple or by the dirt of the gutters. So untainted, beyond all taint, unconnected, and that is called asanga. So asanga swarupa is the nature of the higher nature of the Lord. The Lord is not touched by what he creates. And then we said he is the creator, he is the maintainer, and he is the cause of the destruction of the world. So Ishvara Srishti Sthiti and Laya Karanam, cause of existence, maintenance and destruction of the universe. Why? Because creation arises from Maya. As when creation is there, it is Maya itself, and therefore arising from Maya, creation, existing in Maya, maintenance or sustenance. And when the universe is destroyed, it resolves back into Maya, so destruction. And therefore, it is the creation ground, it is the origin, It is sustenance ground, and it is a dissolution ground also of the entire universe, which we call Srishti, Sthiti and Laya Karana. Then, because of the Asanga status, this Lord is Sakshi Matra. He does not do anything. Why? Because the formless Ishvara, the formless Lord, what is his status? He is present everywhere. If he is present everywhere, then there is nowhere he can move to. And any action, you look at it this way, any action requires movement. So if I have to move one glass from here to here, there is a movement. That form, the boundary of the glass is moved from one space to another point in space. That is what we call movement or action. Any action requires movement. And since the Lord is formless, he is all pervading. If he is all pervading, he is present everywhere. And if he is present everywhere, then where can he move to? An entity which is present everywhere can move nowhere, like space. Space is there everywhere. We don't say space moves. And because space does not move, space cannot do any action also. By the same analogy, the higher nature of Ishvara, Brahman, present everywhere, cannot move and cannot therefore do any action. So he is Sakshi Matra. Because he cannot do anything, he has no doership. And because he has no doership, he does not experience the fruits of any action, because simply because he is not doing any action at all. So Kartrutvam and Bhoktrutvam, the doership and the enjoyership, those two attributes do not apply to the higher nature of Ishvara. Okay. Having done this, then the chapter moves on to samsara, the existing universe, the problems associated with it, and what is the cause of samsara. And Krishna says in the 11th verse, avajananti ma mudaha manushim tanum ashritam param bhavam ajanantah mama bhuta maheshwaram. Is what is the cause of sorrow in this world? Because people do not recognize my higher nature as the Lord of all beings. And therefore he says, he's talking about samsara karanam, cause of sorrow and problems in this world. What is the main problem? The main problem is that we expect something permanent from this world which is impermanent. So put it in other words, I am forever looking for security. Why? Because I think I am insecure. So a very interesting flow of logic. I do not know that I am Ishvara. I do not know that I am the Lord himself. I think I am finite and therefore I am insecure. Because I am insecure, I expect security from somewhere, and that somewhere is where? Right in front of me. But what I see is only this universe. This universe is temporary, and this temporary universe is also insecure because it is constantly changing. And therefore, to expect permanency from what is impermanent, it is not very wise. So the problem here, Krishna says, is there is a wrong expectation. You expect permanent security from this impermanent universe. Universe includes everything. Other people, events, money, whatever you can think of. But you expect that permanence from that impermanent being. And this wrong expectation, says Krishna, is the cause of your problem. If a person wants security, where should he go? If a person wants permanent peace and permanent happiness and permanent security, Krishna says going to this impermanent world is foolishness, because the impermanent world has got neither security nor happiness nor peace. And therefore you should learn to look at that entity which is the embodiment of security, which is the embodiment happiness and peace, which is what? Para Prakriti only, the higher nature of the Lord. And here Krishna says nobody understands this because they have not examined the nature of the Lord, even though the Vedas very clearly give you what is the higher nature and what is the lower nature. People have not bothered to analyze the Vedas. They have not bothered to study the Vedas. And therefore, whatever they see, which is only my lower nature, which is Apara Prakriti, they think that is all that exists. And therefore, they are holding on to this lower nature for peace and happiness, and they don't receive it. And then they complain. So he says, Mudaha. These people are confused, ignorant people who have not been able to differentiate between what is eternal and what is temporary. Remember that whatever is temporary can never give permanent peace and security. This is learning from this verse. Therefore he says, Mama Param Bhavam Ajanantaha. These people do not know my higher nature. And that is a tragedy indeed. Why? Why is it tragedy? Because of this ignorance, because of the fact that they are not aware of my higher nature, they are seeing only the universe, and the universe is my lower nature. And therefore they take this lower nature as the real Lord. And that is the problem. Ashritam Manushim Tanum. They take the form to be the essence. So wherever a form is there, remember, form means a boundary. Boundary means a limitation. And my sense organs can perceive only limited objects. It can never look at something which is formless, because that is the design of the sense organ, because it itself is lower nature. The sense organ itself is part of matter and therefore lower nature. How can it see something which is formless? And therefore, whatever is within the perception of the sense organs can only be the lower nature of Ishvara. And it takes formed or forms as the real form, and then they worship. So he says, this formless Ishvara which I am, they take whichever form they worship. Some of the Rama form, or Devi form, or Krishna form. They take that form as the real Ishvara and they worship. And we can, think about the implication. If I am worshipping the formless Lord as a formed entity, is that a worship? Or is that an insult? So when I do puja, what do? I sit down. And the first thing in any puja, those who are familiar with puja will know, the first thing is you offer a seat to the Lord. Asanam samarpayami. You say, please come and sit down. So the first thing is the invocation of the Lord. Please come and sit down. What are you doing on a 3x3 platform? You want to ask the Lord to sit down. Which Lord is this? This is the Lord who is the platform for the entire universe. And you're asking that Lord to come and sit on a platform which is 3 feet by 3 feet. How foolish can you get is the question. We are not saying that the worship of the individual Lord is not necessary. What is being mentioned here is that Saguna Ishvara, the formed Lord, is a necessary beginning for any seeker. But one has to start with that, understand it cannot be the culmination. You can begin with Saguna, you can begin with the form, but culmination has to be in the Nirguna. Culmination has to be in the formless. So that is the progress. Sagunam to Nirgunam, Apara to Para, formless, form to formless. This is the progression. And that formless nature, that Nirguna Swarupam, these people do not know. Because they don't know, they don't hold on to formless Ishvara. The infinite Ishvara, they don't hold on to. And they expect infinite results from that finite Ishvara. So this is, he says, is the cause of all the problems in this universe. Now, having talked about the higher nature of Ishvara, having talked about the consequences of not understanding this higher nature, which is what is called samsara, which is the cause of all the problems in this universe, now he has to supply some sort of a solution. So the next few verses, he talks about the remedy. So what is the remedy? He says the remedy is bhakti, devotion. And if you remember from our discussions in the previous sessions, bhakti has to be understood not as an action. Bhakti has to be understood as a series of sadhanas. That series of sadhanas has to have a logical culmination, a logical destination. And that destination is jnanam, knowledge alone. All the sadhanas of the Lord with form have to lead you to understanding of the formless Lord. Why? Because the understanding of the formless Lord is what we call knowledge, jnanam. And why is jnanam so important? Because samsara is because of what reason? Not understanding the higher nature, that is ignorance. So ignorance can be sorted out only by knowledge. Solution is only knowledge. And this is what Krishna is saying. The only solution can be a course of action or a series of action which ultimately leads you to coming and understanding my higher nature. Because if darkness is the problem, no amount of karma can take away the darkness. The solution can be only light. So, let us examine what are the various classes of the sadhana. We can talk about sadhana in two or three forms. One is this discipline, the sadhana, can be karma rupa bhakti. Convert all karma, all your actions, convert it to devotion. How do you convert something to devotion? By worship. By bringing the Lord into your life. So even brushing my teeth in the morning, which is a normally considered as an action which has no spiritual, you know, connotations, even that can be converted into a worship. So do that. Every single action you do, if you convert it into worship, that becomes bhakti. So karma rupa bhakti. Bhakti in the form of karma. That is one set of sadhana. Then, upasana rupa bhakti, the second set of sadhana. Train your mind to turn inwards. So bhakti can be in the form of meditation of the formed Lord, of Saguna Ishvara. So you have karma converted into bhakti because Lord is being invoked. You have meditation converted into bhakti because Lord is being invoked. And the third one is the study of the scriptures, which we call Vedanta Vichara. So to convert into sadhana, that also has to be invoked as a bhakti. So Vedanta Vichara Rupa Bhakti. That Jnana Yoga Rupa Bhakti. You're listening to the scriptures, you're contemplating on the teachings, and your efforts at assimilating, which we call Shravanam, Mananam, and Nididhyasanam, all are basically nothing but a form of bhakti. And therefore, bhakti can consist of any number of sadhanas. Ultimately, it has to bring you to Nirguna Ishvara only. It has to bring you to study of the scriptures. So this is what is being referred to as bhakti over here. After going through all these stages, this seeker becomes a knower of Nirguna Ishvara. He becomes a jnani. So what is the remedy here? We look at various aspects. We have very many negative emotions in our mind. So karma. Karma yoga is considered as the discipline by way of which we can nullify or minimize all negative emotions. सो कर्म योगा इन्वोकिंग ईश्वरा बिकम्स कर्म रूप भक्ति, साधना ऑफ कर्म योगा. बट ईश्वरा इज देयर इन योर लाइफ, द लॉर्ड इज देयर इन योर लाइफ, एंड देयरफॉर इट बिकम्स भक्ति इटसेल्फ. व्हाट इज भक्ति? रिकॉग्नाइजिंग द लॉर्ड इटसेल्फ इज भक्ति. एंड देयरफॉर एनी एक्शन यू डू वेर यू रिकॉग्नाइज दैट लॉर्ड इज देयर सेंट्रल टू योर लाइफ, ऑटोमेटिकली भक्ति. सो कर्म योगा बिकम्स भक्ति. It takes care of all the negative tendencies of my mind. Then, what next? I have a wandering mind, what's called vikshepa, the wandering tendencies of the mind. How do I address that? I address that through meditation. Obviously, meditation also, I am invoking the Lord. And therefore, meditation also becomes bhakti. And when I study the scriptures afterwards, obviously, I am studying the nature of the Lord only. That is automatically bhakti. So we have bhakti in the form of karma yoga, bhakti in the form of upasana yoga, and bhakti in the form of jnana yoga. So the bhakti consists of all these three stages progressively. Bhakti can be also classified on the basis of its motives. So on the basis of the bhavana. So you have bhakti, which is devotion or actions which are being done, worship which is being done for the sake of, let us say, fulfillment of my material desires. So sakama bhakti. And you can have nishkam bhakti also, where I am worshipping for the purity of my mind alone. I don't have any material desires. So if you look at sakama bhakti, the motive is for worldly finite fruits. And Vedanta doesn't consider sakama bhakti as a very intelligent action, because bhakti is used for temporary goals, for ephemeral goals. We are using bhakti for what is pleasant, not for what is good for us. So artha kama, among the purusharthas, artha kama is called bhakti, which is lower form of bhakti, sakama bhakti. It is not that it is prohibited. It is very much recommended in the Vedas as a starting point. So I will use them, I will enjoy the benefits, I will mature. And if I am doing it only for my material benefits, then because I am a bhakt anyway, because I have Ishvara in my life, I will generate good karma, punyam. And when this life ends, because of that generation of the punyam, because of the stock of the punyam which I have, I will go to a higher region or a better life, finish off, exhaust that punyam, and then come back. So go up and come back. And therefore, sakama bhakti is not very highly recommended, but yes, it is necessary for a starter. Now, nishkama bhakti is one who has matured a bit. He has understood that sakama bhakti has no real potential, because one goes and one returns. So nishkam bhakta is the one who understands that material benefits, or in the language of this chapter, apara prakriti does not give security. And therefore he looks at the higher nature, para prakriti, for giving lasting security and peace. And how should this nishkama bhakta worship? So beautifully given in a verse, patram pushpam phalam toyam. Yome bhaktya prayachati tadaham bhakti uparatam ashnami prayat atmanaha. He says, whoever offers me with devotion a leaf, a flower, a fruit, or even water, if that devotion is pure minded, I will accept that devotion. So in the scriptures, remember that we talk not just about nishkama bhakti, we talk about sakama bhakti also. For example, you have something which is called the putra kameshtu yajna. It's a ritual which people do who do not have children, which couples do when they don't have children and they desire children, they desire offspring. Then that particular ritual, putra kameshtu yajna, is done for that purpose. Is it sakama or nishkama? It is sakama, because you are wanting something worldly, you are wanting a child. On the other hand, यू हैव समथिंग एज सिंपल एज संध्या वंदनम. इट्स अ निष्काम रिचुअल प्योरली मेंट फॉर चित्तशुद्धि, फॉर द क्लैरिटी, फॉर द प्योरिटी ऑफ द माइंड. एंड प्योरिटी ऑफ द माइंड इज इन्वोक्ड वॉट फॉर? प्योरली सो दैट यू कैन कम टू नॉलेज. एंड वाई डू यू कम टू नॉलेज? सो दैट यू कैन कम टू एंड गेट मोक्ष. Now, in the scriptures, all the rituals meant for sakama purposes, for materialistic purposes, they are accompanied by a whole set of rules and regulations. A particular puja, a particular time, particular number of bricks, arranged in a particular manner, particular number of pujaris, and so on and so forth. And the Vedas say that if these are not followed, then at the best, you will not get any result at all. So the higher the material benefit that you seek, the more complicated, the more complex the rituals are. For a very, very complex, very, very, you know, highly or a very major material benefit, if you are wanting, the ritual will be a very complex one. But in the case of Nishkama Bhakti, in the case of Bhakti, where you are not asking for anything material, what is the beauty? That you can make any number of mistakes. The mistakes will not adversely affect you. We are not recommending that you should deliberately make mistakes, right? But for example, to take, you are chanting a Sahasranama for purity, for Chitta Shuddhi. It is a Nishkama ritual because you are not asking for anything material. You can chant it for material things also. But we are taking the example of a person who is chanting on a regular basis for the purpose of Chitta Shuddhi only, purity of mind only. Then, what is the purpose of the purity of mind? To enable me to come to knowledge. What is the purpose of coming to knowledge? To enable me to get moksha. And therefore, in my chanting, if there are a few pronunciation mistakes, if I have done some meter wrong, it doesn't really matter because there is no material benefit. So scriptures give you one easy way out over here. If you are doing for Chitta Shuddhi, for benefit which is purely by way of purity of mind, then Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam. Whatever you offer, there is fine. There is no restriction at all. What is important? Bhaktya prayachati. You have to offer with devotion, recognizing me as Ishvara. So he is actually defining karma yoga here. If you remember our discussion on chapter 3, any karma performed by recognizing Ishvara becomes karma yoga. So karma plus bhakti is equal to karma yoga. And he says prayat atmanaha. Such a person who does not have a desire for any finite results, who does not do it for raga, dvesha, for worldly benefits, he has become a purified mind, prayat atmanaha, and he says, aham ashnami, I will gladly receive this offering. So the moment the offering is received by the Lord, the grace of the Lord becomes available. So Ishvara Anugraha becomes available as soon as Ishvara accepts our offerings. So prayer, therefore, is an act of pure will, right? This is what is being mentioned here, that anytime you pray, it's actually an act of pure will. When you are dejected, when your confidence has taken a beating, when the entire world, the entire creation seems to be working overtime against me, we should always try the remedy of prayer. Pray with an open heart. And of course, easy to say, but praying with an open heart is not easy if you are new to prayer. When I'm new to prayer, what will happen? It's like cleaning up, you know, a dirty toilet. First, I have to clean all the dirt, and therefore there will be a lot of stink. And therefore, the first few attempts at prayer, all my pain, all my cynicism, everything will surface and will shake my mind. But if I persist, very soon this disappears. the clean surface begins to show, it will require several such attempts before I can really begin to pray with an open heart, with a whole heart. And once I do this, this act of prayer, this act of devotion, it becomes very important. Why? Because prayer can be done only if I accept my own limitations as a jiva. For it is always the jiva who prays. And recognition of Ishvara's limitlessness. I am a jiva, Ishvara is limitless. This recognition is the final act of surrender. And how long does one need to pray? As long as bhakti is, you know, a coming and going function. I am devout at some time, I am cynical at some time. So devotion is not consistent. As long as that is there, I need to pray. But once I have stabilized, once I have been praying long enough, I will discover that bhakti becomes a permanent state. This surrender becomes a permanent state. There is therefore no need for a separate prayer, because my whole life has become one long prayer. And this is why Krishna glorifies bhakti. And bhakti has several layers, which we will talk about in later chapters. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnam Eva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om Bolo Sadguru Shivanand Maharaj Ki Jai. Om Bolo Swami Vishnu Devanand Maharaj Ki Jai. Om Tat Sat. Om Namah Shivaya. Thank you for your patience. I look forward to seeing you on next Saturday for the 10th chapter. Om Tat Sat. Om Namah Shivaya.